We move now to a discussion of the Treaty of Versailles, the 14 points, and the League of Nations. This is a potential essay topic. Once again, we will be talking about the Treaty of Versailles, the 14 points, and the League of Nations, and I will explain each of these in some pretty substantial detail. So let's go ahead and get started. Woodrow Wilson was ever the idealist, and as an idealist and progressive, he went before Congress in January of 1918 with something called the 14 Points. The 14 Points were authored by Wilson and a group of economists, historians, geographers, and attorneys, this group of men collectively known as the Inquiry. And the 14 points was this very ambitious written proposal to ensure peace globally in the aftermath of World War I. Germany had been defeated. In October of 1918, the Allied forces captured French territory that Germany had formerly occupied. The German Kaiser Wilhelm II was forced to abdicate. He stepped down, and Germany implemented a new republican government known as the Weimar Republic. And the Weimar Republic proposed an armistice or a ceasefire based on Woodrow Wilson's 14 points. So that this tells us that the Germans liked the 14 points, and for some very obvious reasons that we'll get into now. Woodrow Wilson's 14 points summed up progressive aims of the United States with regards to Europe in the aftermath of the war. This was Wilson's idealistic notions of how to Americanize the globe and impose his progressive ideals of good government and American capitalism abroad. Woodrow Wilson's 14 points advocated peace without victory. In January of 1917, Wilson predicted that any punitive settlement or treaty imposed by the victorious upon the vanquished would breed hatred and more wars. And in this, he was a visionary. For all his faults, the one thing that Woodrow Wilson absolutely got right is that he knew that peace without victory was the only logical course, that if the victors or the winners tried to punish Germany and the Austro-Hungarians with this treaty, that it would only lead to more war, and he was absolutely correct in this determination. The 14 points also dealt with how relations between the combatants could be normalized, how European borders would be redrawn in the aftermath of war, and how colonial holdings would be partitioned. So let's take just a little bit of time. I'm not going to go through all of the 14 points, but I do want you to understand some of the fundamentals of the 14 points. The 14 points stated that there should be no secret treaties, no secret treaties, that everything should be out in the open. This was an attempt to prevent some of these mutual protection pact alliances that had been so problematic leading up to World War I. The 14 points also suggested that there should be freedom of the seas, that all nations should be able to travel freely on the high seas, that boats should be able to fish off the shore of any nation that they might choose. I will suggest to you that this was also incredibly naive. However, this is what Woodrow Wilson was suggesting. Free trade. Woodrow Wilson believed very strongly, as did most progressives, that free trade was a way of creating conditions of peace around the world. That if all nations traded with one another, with limited tariffs and barriers to trade or impediments to trade, that it would reduce tensions around the world. And there's certainly something to that logic. Demilitarization. Arms should be reduced to the lowest point consistent with domestic safety. So he wanted to see all of the various nations reduce their armaments, and indeed there were several nations that would try to reduce their military force in the aftermath of World War I, and as it turns out, it ended up being quite problematic because not everyone followed that agreement, in particular the Germans. The adjustment of colonial claims were going to take place according to the 14 points. So if Woodrow Wilson got his way, it meant that many of the colonized nations around the world would ideally be given some modicum of self-determination. And so the phrase that I use here is with equal interest to popular sovereignty and the governments currently in control of the land. So what this means is that Woodrow Wilson and many progressives believe that the imperial nations, Britain, France, Germany, Belgium, that these nations needed to reduce their influence around the world and needed to allow colonized nations more autonomy, more freedom, or popular sovereignty. And so the hope was that the imperial grip of many of these superpower nations would be loosened to just a little bit, in order to allow the people that were colonized or conquered a bit more freedom, to govern themselves, if you will. Well, Woodrow Wilson arrived for the Paris Peace Conference in 1919 with very high hopes. Incredibly ambitious were the 14 points. And I will tell you that when Woodrow Wilson arrived in Paris, it was like a conquering hero because of the United States' role in assisting the French and the British in defeating Germany. Relations between the United States and France had never been better. When he arrived in the streets of Paris, children were throwing flower petals at the man's feet. And so relations could never have been better. But I will also tell you that when Woodrow Wilson arrived for the Paris Peace Conference, he, being a Democrat, brought only an entourage of Democrats with him. He declined to bring a single Republican with him, and as it turns out, this would be a major political blunder on his part, moving forward. Now, when the conference itself convened, the Paris Peace Conference, where the Treaty of Versailles would be signed, Great Britain and France were in the mood to punish Germany for the devastation inflicted by 4 years of bombing and disease and catastrophic death. So the 14 points would be the kind of blueprint for the Treaty of Versailles, but Woodrow Wilson was quite dismayed when he found out that the victors in the war began to dismantle the 14 points and to alter the 14 points. And so his ideas of peace without victory quickly went away in favor of a much more punitive treaty that would be quite harmful to Germany in particular. The fact was, they had very little interest in Wilson's peace without victory theme. So the resulting Treaty of Versailles placed the entire blame on the war on Germany's soldiers. Now, based on what we've seen already in this class, you know that that is not true, that Germany should not have been the sole culprit, or should not have shouldered culpability for World War I, but in fact, that is how the treaty was written up. Germany was forced to accept sole responsibility. And so Wilson's ideas were largely disregarded and ensured that tensions in Europe would increase rather than decrease over time. The treaty was signed June 1919. Just a few of the demands that were placed on Germany. They were forced to demilitarize. They were forced to reduce their armed forces and were not allowed to have a standing army. And in theory, they weren't supposed to have tanks or airplanes or ships or submarines or any of those things. They were forced to basically dismantle a good portion of their military force and their mechanized military. Germany was also stripped of much of the territory in Europe that it had conquered in previous decades. So, Germany had been an empire, had been empire building and expanding, and had captured a lot of territory in what is today Czechoslovakia and Poland. And this territory was stripped from them as a result of the Treaty of Versailles. This was quite humiliating to Germans. So, they were being diminished as a nation and as a people. They were also stripped of colonies in Africa, and those colonies were given to France and Great Britain. So Tanzania, Burundi, Rwanda, Mozambique, and Namibia all changed hands from Germany, an imperial power, to Britain and France, other imperial powers. And so there would be no autonomy for those people in those nations. Those African people who hoped for a brief moment that they might be given independence would see no such independence. If you take a look at this map, you'll also note that there were several reconstituted nations out of the territory that had been stripped from the Germans. Poland and Czechoslovakia was created, as well as Yugoslavia, carved out of the former Ottoman Empire territories. And so Austria-Hungary was punished, as was Germany and the Ottomans, and several new nations were reconstituted as a result of the Treaty of Versailles. So there was some nation building going on as a result of the Treaty of Versailles as well. But it did mean the right of self-determination for several people. Yet another clause in the Treaty of Versailles was the guilt clause. Germany was forced to accept sole responsibility for the war, and they were forced to make reparations payments to the Allies for the total cost of the war. And when I say the total cost of the war, that is what I mean. They were forced to pay not only the German government for the cost of the war, but excuse me, not the German government, the British and French government for the cost of the war, but they were also forced to pay Individuals that had lost a home, a farm, a cow, they were forced to make restitution to individuals as well. And so the burden of debt, this $56 billion payment, this was such an overpowering and overburdening debt that it absolutely devastated the German economy. You have to understand that when reparations payments were accepted by the Weimar Republic, this new German government, it was at a time when German currency, the Deutschmark, was valueless. It was worth nothing. They could, if you had loaded it into bags and into boxes and taken it to the store, you could not have purchased a loaf of bread with it. And so, at the worst possible time, they are being saddled with these reparations payments. Eventually, that amount, $56 billion, would be reduced to $9 billion, and it was still more than Germany could pay at that time. So those billions in reparations absolutely devastated the German economy. It created an atmosphere of resentment and hostility and desperation. The German government was also terribly resented for signing the treaty. The Weimar Republic was under fire from the moment it took office because it accepted the punitive components of the Treaty of Versailles. And so, in the aftermath of the signing of the Treaty of Versailles, it led to depressions and recessions, economic turmoil, and a real sense of desperation amongst German people. And it led to the emergence of radical ideas and radical leaders. I am sure that you know where I am going with this. These reparations payments were what we call triangular reparations payments or cyclical reparations payments. Germany could have never made those reparations payments. They were devastated economically. But American banking interests stepped in and assisted the new German Republic. American banks extended loan after loan to Germany, who then sent that money to Britain and France in the form of reparation payments. However, Britain and France, in turn, sent that money back to the United States to pay off the war debts that they had accumulated borrowing from the U.S. during the war. So understand, the United States is loaning the money with interest to Germany, and it's receiving a similar value of money back from Britain and France with interest. So the United States is making interest on the front and back side of these loans. This was a tremendous boom for the United States. The U.S. became the preeminent economic power in the world as a result of World War I. There were also efforts by colonial nations to gain independence. If you take a look at the man to top right, this is the communist leader of Vietnam, Ho Chi Minh. And Ho Chi Minh was actually at the Paris Peace Conference in 1919. He was a young man at that time. He was a strong Vietnamese nationalist, and he wanted Vietnam to be liberated from French colonial rule, and he was ignored. As a result of him being ignored and not being given some degree of autonomy for his people, he returned to Vietnam. He embraced socialism and communism, and the United States would end up fighting a very long war against North Vietnam and Ho Chi Minh to try and defeat communism or to prevent the spread of communism. And so there were some rather insidious implications related to the Treaty of Versailles and some of the great oversights that were made by the treaty signers. On the left there, you see Vladimir Lenin. Vladimir Lenin was upset that the Bolshevik government was not recognized by the treaty signers because they were a usurper government, the Bolsheviks, because they were not the legitimate government at that time. They were given no role in the Treaty of Versailles signing process, nor were they invited to the Paris Peace Conference, and so this obviously agitated Russia quite a bit. These reparations payments did very little to assist the Germans, and in the aftermath of World War I, German nationalism grew. Many Germans pushed for Germany to reclaim its greatness, and many scholars have argued that the punitive component of the Treaty of Versailles was the most significant contributing factor to the outbreak of World War II. I will tell you that some scholars even argue that World War I and World War II should be considered part of the same war, with a 20-year hiatus or intermediary period in between. The Treaty of Versailles did recognize the independence of quite a few countries: Poland, the Baltic states of Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, which Germany had taken from Russia. Two new nations, Czechoslovakia and Yugoslavia, were created out of the former Austro-Hungarian and Ottoman empires, as I alluded to earlier. Now, the 14 points was a total failure for Woodrow Wilson, but he hoped to salvage something of his his progressive dream for peace worldwide, and that would come in the form of the League of Nations. The League of Nations was an organization that he hoped would mediate disputes and problems worldwide. He hoped to create a harmonious and rational world order, and so the League of Nations would, he hoped, be his only legacy. So a brief overview of the League of Nations. There would be five permanent members on the League of Nations and a nine-member executive council. As you can see, in theory, at least in writing, it was supposed to be the United States, Britain, France, Italy, and Japan. Four of the five nations that you see there would become members of the League of Nations. The only one that would not would be, ironically, the United States. Even though Woodrow Wilson authored the League of Nations, the United States would reject the League of Nations. Now, in theory, the League of Nations would vote on issues important to world peace, and members of the League were required to wait 6 months before going to war. And amazingly, the Allied powers agreed to the League of Nations, but the United States was another story. Congress was very wary of the League of Nations. They felt that it compromised America's ability to conduct foreign policy on its own terms, and they rejected Woodrow Wilson's plan. And so the result was that the U.S. never joined the League of Nations, and a lot of it had to do with Woodrow Wilson's arrogance. When he returned from Paris, he, you know, wanted to take sole responsibility. Remember, he hadn't invited any Republicans, and he felt like this was his plan for world peace, and Republicans were having none of it. They accepted the League of Nations into Congress, and they began to deliberate and debate upon it, and they began to dismantle it. And during all of this, it really was a great challenge for Woodrow Wilson. He actually took the issue to the American people. He began to campaign around the nation. And then he was stricken with a stroke in the fall of 1919. He was actually incapacitated for a period of time. He also contracted the Spanish flu, that very virulent flu virus that killed so many people worldwide. And it really devastated him physically and prevented him from campaigning as ardently as he might have. And so in the aftermath of World War I, the U.S. did not become a member of the League of Nations. Europe was in ruin. A generation of people had lost their lives. A global influenza pandemic claimed the lives of 40 million people. Some claim as many as 50 million people between 1970 and 1919. There would now be a monumental rebuilding project. The map of Europe was radically altered as a result of the Treaty of Versailles. It led to a rise of nationalism in many European countries, many humiliated countries with a strong sense of identity and wanting to make their country great once again. And that includes Germany, who was terribly humiliated, and Germans were quite bitter in the aftermath of the defeat. The war caused death and destruction in the Middle East and in Africa. Anywhere that fighting took place, it caused economic and social stress in all of the European colonial empires. And societies all over the world contributed resources and soldiers to the war effort, gaining experience and a firmer voice on the global stage. And so World War I was a war that had some more beneficial consequences as well. Many people who fought for their colonizers were also fighting for themselves. They were gaining a valuable experience as warriors, as soldiers, and soon they would turn those guns on their colonial occupiers in many cases. Women all over the world took new responsibilities outside of the home and as part of the total war effort. As you can see there, some powerful image. Russian women in uniform marching with guns in France, women taking to the fields and tilling the fields, you know, and trying to keep the economy moving during the war. And in the United States, as you can see, factory workers. There were many nationalist leaders that emerged out of the chaos of World War I. Ho Chi Minh in Vietnam, whom I've already mentioned, Nehru and Gandhi in India, Nehru and Kwame Nkrumah in Ghana,